Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Patriot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed Jesus. These 12 were sent out by Jesus with the following instructions. Do not go to any Gentile territory or any Samaritan towns. Instead, you are to go to the lost sheep of the people of Israel. Go and preach that the kingdom of heaven is near. Heal the sick, bring the dead back to life, heal those who suffer from dreaded skin diseases, and drive out demons. You have received this without paying, so give without being paid. Do not carry any gold, silver, or copper money in your pockets. Do not carry a beggar's bag for the trip, or an extra shirt, or shoes, or a walking stick. Workers will be given what they need. When you come to a town or village, go in and look for someone who is willing to welcome you, and stay with them until you leave that place. When you go into a house, say, "Peace be with you." If the people in that house welcome you, let your greeting of peace remain. But if they do not welcome you, then take back your greeting. If some home or town will not welcome you or listen to you, then leave that place and shake the dust off your feet. I assure you that on Judgment Day, God will show more mercy to the people of Sodom and Gomorrah than to the people of that town. Listen, I am sending you out just like sheep to a pack of wolves. You must be as cautious as snakes and as gentle as doves. Watch out, for there will be those who will arrest you and take you to court, and they will whip you in the synagogues. For my sake, you will be brought to trial before rulers and kings to tell the good news to them and to the Gentiles. When they bring you to trial, do not worry what you're going to say or how you will say it. When the time comes, you will be given what to say. For the words you speak will not be yours. They will come from the Spirit of God speaking through you. People will hand over their own brothers to be put to death, and fathers will do the same to their children. Children will turn against parents and have them put to death. Everyone will hate you because of me. But whoever holds out to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, run to another one. I assure you, you will not finish your work in all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. A word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. session of the Illinois Conference of the United Church of Christ at Elmhurst College. It's called an annual celebration, but it's not really just a big party. It's not even actually close to being a big party. It's really actually our annual business meeting with committee reports and election of officers, discussion of resolutions, those sorts of things. And it also includes an educational element. What the workshops are called energizers. So you're sensing the notion of positioning when you're trying to get people to do things. These energizers are designed to help us tackle issues that many of our churches are facing today. So some of this year's workshops included student ministry in the contemporary church, engaging faith communities with sustaining creation, and mission partnerships, expanding our witness. And that one was really cool because it was led by the Angola Partnership, and we actually had some of our partners from Angola there. And of course, the celebration also included some wonderful, inspirational, prophetic preaching and worship. The theme of this year's celebration was Churching Outside the Box, which is clearly a play on that familiar expression, thinking outside the box. And as you might expect, the goal was to share new ideas and get us to think creatively, try new things, kind of like that. We're gonna keep trying. And that's not always an easy task, not just because technology won't always cooperate, but because the church is an institution that's largely focused on sharing a gospel message that's over 2,000 years old. And we spend a lot of time preserving and passing down our traditions. The invitation at the annual celebration, though, made it clear that the theme wasn't just chosen because it's trendy to think outside the box, although it is a clever play on words. Our conference leadership saw this as an urgent topic, one that we needed to address in community. And so I'd like to share with you an excerpt from the letter that came from Michael Linder, the president of the Illinois Conference. In a time where there are so many social ills to be addressed, and while church attendance nationally and often locally has decreased, we still recognize that many times it is the local church that is best equipped to transform lives in our communities. Where there continues to be great value in our traditional patterns of church worship and mission to reach more members of our communities, to reach those most in need of hope and faith, we need to get outside of the walls of our sanctuaries. We need to do churching outside the box. So I left the meeting last Saturday with a few new ideas and a renewed commitment to be more creative in my approach to ministry, particularly with youth and young adults. I plan to broaden my search for inspiration through talking with more people, reading more books, visiting other churches, borrowing some ideas from even outside the church. Because if something's good in real life at creating engagement, it might work at church as well, so we might want to give it a try. But then, I thought I kind of got what the idea of churching outside the box was. But then this week, as I was reading and rereading the Matthew scripture, churching outside the box began to have much deeper implications for me. The first thing that struck me was how familiar the situation was that Jesus found himself in. His observation that everywhere he traveled, everywhere he looked, there were people in need of help. He was doing what he could, which by all accounts was miraculous and life-giving, but it still wasn't enough. The need was overwhelming. And I'm certainly not trying to compare myself to Jesus in any way, but I definitely have that feeling of being overwhelmed by the needs of the world, right here in our local geography, as well as a member of the global community. It hits me on the individual level when I see people asking for money as I go to get on the expressway, whether I'm going east or west, or as I walk down the streets of Chicago. It creeps into my inbox through the Wall Street Journal's news alerts and fills my Facebook feed with stories of tragedies, terrorism, justice denied. And it touches me personally, through people sharing their stories, through conversation, text messages, caring bridge posts, or prayer. Like Jesus, I see the size and the depth of the need, and I move to compassion, but sadly, that's often where the similarities end. In fact, I've noticed in the past few months that I'm starting to show signs of compassion fatigue, not in the clinical secondary traumatic stress manner that's diagnosed in long-term caregivers, but rather in the more generalized sense of gradually lessening of compassion over time, caused simply by the sheer amount of need. I see so much need, so much suffering, and so much unfairness and injustice that I can become paralyzed by the amount of healing that is needed. And so in order to keep functioning, I pick and I choose. I give to that person who asks, I don't give to the other one. I respond to some causes, I march sometimes, I don't march other times. And I choose what to care about, what to participate in, and frankly, what I can pretend to not notice. I rationalize this by saying to myself, at least I'm doing something. After all, I can't do everything. But I still feel bad, and the need is still great. So this is where today's text hit me personally, right between the eyes. Jesus couldn't do it by himself either. Kind of awesome. He prayed for help. He called together some of his followers, his students. He gave them new skills, and he sent them out as apostles with a specific mission to heal suffering and incite justice. Maybe this was the first example of churching outside the box. Another old-fashioned name for it would be evangelism. Now, I'm guessing that's not a word that you use regularly, and perhaps haven't even heard all that recently. And for many, it's likely to have some negative associations. For me, having been raised in a liberal Protestant tradition, not that dissimilar to Pilgrim, when I think of an evangelist, there's a stereotypical image that pops into my head of someone bombarding me with their beliefs, demanding I repent from whatever I'm doing that seems remotely fun at the moment, and join them in their well-meaning cult. Now, full transparency, that unflattering image was heavily influenced by the time I spent hanging out with people in the evangelical tradition when I was in high school, who probably were saying some of those things to me. And I'm not trying to suggest that it's in any way accurate, but rather to say that I, and I'm guessing some of you, might be less than 100% comfortable with the idea of evangelism, and probably don't necessarily think of yourself as an evangelist. But what if we really are? Or maybe we should be. What if my compassionate response, our compassionate response to the great need and the things that we see in the world, was to use our skills and resources collectively to bring healing and incite justice? And that's kind of what an evangelist would do. And I think we actually already do that in many ways, but I would have to say, I think we have some room for improvement. In my humble observation of myself and in my community, I think that often when I do these things, I'm seen, or we're seen, as good people doing good things. I don't know that we're necessarily seen as Pilgrim Church spreading the good news of the gospel. And that means we're doing good things, which is good, but I and we are missing an opportunity to spread both help and the message of God's love to those in need. Amen. And I actually think that's a big miss. The help we can bring gives immediate relief, and that's key. But planting the seed that God loves you just as you are can bring a glimmer of hope that might outlast our immediate efforts. Because if we're honest, we have to admit that for many folks, the idea of God is about as frightening as the idea of evangelism, maybe even more. Their lived experiences may have told them that God is judgmental, hard to please, and quick to judge and punish. They may feel rejected by God because people who claim to love God have rejected them.
Amen.
Perhaps they've been victims of tragedy or misfortune and been told it was God's will. Mm. Or maybe they just feel invisible, overlooked by society and probably by God as well. Feeling that kind of isolation, alienation, and rejection can cause as much tangible suffering as being hungry and homeless. We just might not be able to see it quite as easily. But helplessness can lead to hopelessness. What if each of us, though, in our own way, started to get more comfortable with our role as evangelists? As Maureen said, to do the things, to be Christ to people, but also letting our compassion lead us to share the story of our faith journeys and our participation in a community of faith have helped to strengthen and sustain us when the going got rough. Not just show God's love, but also occasionally talk about God's love. And the fact that the source of our showing God's love is actually our relationship with God, whatever that looks like. Some of us might feel very comfortable speaking about the power of God directly, while others might be more comfortable speaking about God more indirectly by speaking about the church or about our community, our local church, our local denomination, or our wider denomination. Either way, we would be sharing the message of God's love and communicating that we are not alone. And more importantly, those who are in need are not alone. This also helps us to remember that those of us who are trying to help are not alone. We do this work and God is with us always. And that is critically important because as Jesus notes in the text, this is hard and sometimes dangerous work. Oddly enough, acting out of compassion isn't always welcomed or greeted with appreciation. Often it requires speaking truth to power, which can be career limiting or even life threatening. It is, however, the work that Jesus calls us to do. The need is great, and the workers are few. We are being called to church outside the box. How will we respond?